So today I'm talking with Andre Popp, the founder and chief executive of Human API. Andre is my favorite kind of person, an entrepreneur, trained in political science at the University of British Columbia. He's now starting his second technology company.
Thanks so much for having me.
So Human API is illustrative of a lot of the things we've talked about so far in the course. I'm very excited to have you here because I think it brings together many pieces in a tangible way that's easy to understand and easy to demonstrate. So let's start by talking about the fundamentals of what you do. And for that, we've assembled a few toys here, right? So
let's do it.
I'm a patient, and this device is measuring my blood pressure or my activity or
or
whatever. Tell me what you can do for me. Starting at that device.
And so the idea for us really was we wanted to make it really simple for this data to flow from this device into wherever it needed to go, whether that was for research, for a doctor, you know, for a nurse practitioner, you name it. And so what this device would have, and sort of the other really important part of the system, is somewhere over here in a totally different part is you have a, say, personal health record system, and it's floating away from me, but let's just use this for the time being. So you start with this, and what we said is, okay, this device will now already has a connection to a phone of some kind, right? So let's put that there. Great. And then somewhere along the way, it finds its way into a cloud system of some kind, right? So now you've got blood pressure data that's flowing from this device to the phone into this cloud system, and then over here you've got
And typically, this cloud system would be provided by the company that provides the device.
That's right.
That's the norm.
That's right. And so now, but now you're over here and you're talking to your doctor and you're trying to say, okay, I've collected all this blood pressure data and I'd like to actually get it into the system. How do I do that? And so that's where we come in. So what we provide is you essentially, and I'll show you how this works a little later on, but you essentially would click a button inside of this personal health record system, you know, just like you were logging into an app with Facebook. And what would then happen is we would say, look, we're going to grab your data from this blood pressure device, we being Human API. We're going to pull it into our backend. We're going to structure and normalize it, and then we will send it onto there. And so I'll show you how that works. But essentially, we now sit right in the middle here. This is us. And so now the data is flowing from this device through the phone up through the cloud service to us and to the personal health record.
And of course, it wouldn't just be data from this device. It could be data from several devices.
Of course.
Could be data the patient has recorded in their PHR.
Right.
Could be any health data, really, is assembled into this patient control database.
That's right. So now, for example, let's say you have a different device over here, and then, you know, you're trying to query data from that, and same sort of tree-like structure that would flow down from there. And now here's where it gets really interesting. So now that we have the central identity that you can query through an API, you know, as long as the patient grants access. Let's say you're using a totally different personal health record system, right? So you've got some other application over here. We've already got your data here. So now all you need to do is go inside of the system, click our button, and the connection is made. And now anytime you capture blood pressure on this device, it will automatically flow up the chain and into all of these different systems.
So that's what Human API does. From the point of view of the course, maybe the more interesting story is how you do it. So for that, we're going to clear the table. And let's take a look. So I guess this is a PHR or some other tool that the patient might be using.
Right, exactly. So for example, we mentioned that connect button that allows you to pull data from all of these different devices. So what we've actually done here is we, you know, this would be some sort of personal health record system. And somewhere inside of here, you'd have this connect your health data button. And now what you do when you click that button is we serve up this this pop-up that basically says, look, this wellness portal or PHR system wants permission to access your health data, and we're going to pull it through Human API. Now this is really important because central to our philosophy and how we approach this business is to put the patient in the driver's seat in this case. And so what ends up happening is the patient grants access to the system. And now what's happening on the back end here is we've created an identity for that patient in our system. And we're essentially saying, okay, look, now we have all of these different sources. So for this example, you know, Fitbit, Jawbone, Nike, and Moose, but it could be any one of these, right? And so we might say, okay, let's let's go ahead and authenticate a Fitbit, or let's go ahead and authenticate, you know, a Moves application against human API. And so this allows us to connect each of those different data sources, and it could be a blood pressure monitor, it could be another PHR system, you know, you name it.
And just be, so Moves is an app that keeps track of people's activity.
That's right.
And Fitbit is another approach to keeping track of people's activity through a device.
That's right.
One using the phone, one using a device.
And so that's actually a really, really important point as well, because what we do on our end that also sort of helps move this process along from the perspective of the application that's pulling in our data is we actually normalize this data. And so if you think about having steps, for example, as a metric that's being recorded, maybe by an app on your phone, maybe by a pedometer you wear, maybe by a smartwatch that has an accelerometer in it, all of the data from the perspective of the application is actually just steps. And so what we do on our end is we structure and normalize that data before we send it onto the application, which makes it much easier for them to
build. This is a really key point.
As
everyone taking the course knows, interoperability is one of the overriding challenges in health informatics. And you sit in the middle and don't just aggregate the data, but you put it into a standard syntax so that it's much easier on the other side to access the data, as we'll see in a
place. So why don't I show you kind of how that works. So I will go to here and I will show you. You saw that authentication process sort of happen on the back end, right? So once that authentication process has happened, the data starts flowing from human API, so from the device to human API and into these various systems. Right now, what does this actually look like? Well, if you have, and you know, for to kind of geek out a little bit here, but we basically give an access token for a user to the application. So in this case, we're using the demo access token, but each user of the application would have their own unique token. And then it's a RESTful API that we can query. And so we say, look, api.humanapi.co, human blood pressure. And here you can see structured data, systolic and diastolic blood pressure that's come off of a Withings blood pressure monitor. And then here's another sort of very, one thing you can do here is actually change the date range, for example. You can sort of modify this query on the fly. So if you're, if you're building an experience for a physician that wants to look at this data at some point, you as an application developer can choose how you interpret this data for that physician once it's in your system. If, for example, you wanted to actually visualize it, we can do that on the fly as well. So rather than using the api.humanapi.co endpoint, you would just use chart, and there it is. And if you wanted to, change the dimensions of this or, do any of that stuff, you can do that on the fly as well.
So it's important to look at the URI here, the RESTful API, and see how simple it is. And in fact, it's essentially human readable. So getting to this data becomes much, much simpler. And there's only a reference here to blood pressure. The app developer or the query, the source that's querying the data, doesn't have to know what device is being used, doesn't have to know anything about that device, doesn't have to understand their data streams or formats or syntaxes. They're going to get it in the standard form through your system.
Exactly. So what we do is we abstract all of that away. So if you actually look at our back end here, you'll see we have this tool we call the API Explorer. And what you can essentially do in here is you can see all of the different types of data that you can query. So blood glucose, blood pressure levels, BMI. And so really important to this idea of normalization is we're not actually taking Withings data, for example, and just passing it on to the developers. What we're actually doing is making sure that the data is very clean and very structured, and that enables the application developer to really focus on the experience that they want to create without worrying about where the data comes from and all of that stuff.
Well, this is great. This is an example, I think, of the future of interoperability. So
thank you.
I'm glad that we're able to show the students tomorrow today. Thanks for coming.
Thank you so much for having me.